Good morning. Happy Resurrection Sunday. Amen. Let's all stand up. I tell you, people really don't realize how important his death, his burial, and his resurrection was to our lives, even today. I mean, it changed everything. Amen. And that's what we're going to think back and remember. Remember, because we're going to proclaim what? His death till he comes. Amen. Let's worship our Lord and Savior this Easter.
Amen, church. As Pastor said, today, Resurrection Sunday, is a day that changed the history of mankind forever. It's the day that our Savior conquered death, conquered the grave, conquered Satan, and reigned victorious. Amen. Let's invite his presence here this morning. Father, we are so thankful to be in your house on this amazing day that changed everything and gave us a chance for life eternity with you, Father. We thank you and praise your name for that. In Jesus' name, hallelujah. God, we invite your presence here this morning. Thank you. We invite your presence here this morning. Sorry, Father, hallelujah. God, we just invite your presence here. We ask that we would tangibly feel your presence here, Father God. Open our eyes, our ears to hear what you want us to hear, to see what you want us to see. Open our hearts, Father God. Let people see the truth that have never been able to see the truth, God, as we proclaim and tell the story of the gospel here this morning, God. Give all of us an understanding of that. In Jesus' mighty name, and we all said amen. Are you guys ready to worship the Lord? Hallelujah. Here we go, church. I believe in the gospel of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Salvation, one doorway that leads to life, one redemption, one confession. I believe in the name of Jesus Christ.
Do you believe in that? Come on, let's sing it, church.
I believe in the crucifixion. By his blood I have been set free. I believe in the resurrection.
Praise
to God the Father, all praise to
trust in God. He promised to never leave or forsake us. And I know He's just true to His word. Trust in Him this morning.
And he heard.
So I throw up my hands and praise you again and again. Cause all that I have is a home. It's all I have, Father, but it's yours.
Ooh.
every breath you have.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Thank you,
Jesus. You may be seated. It's offering time here at the Lord's church. I'm going to ask the ushers to come on down. We're going to actually come to you this Easter Sunday. Usually we have people come down and bring their tithe and offering, but we're going to have the ushers come to you. Just a couple announcements before we start our production. Steve Duma, the gentleman that's been playing Jesus, I believe he's been playing Jesus since 1984 here at the church. You can do the math. That's a long time. Yeah. And he is a Los Angeles County Sheriff, retired. So if you don't look like cops, you might get a little laugh at that. But we are a pro-cop church. That's just a little joke there. Amen? But just a couple things. If you have little ones, this can sometimes be a little graphic. I mean, we crucify a man. Amen? So the foundation of this gospel was founded on suffering. So we do have kids' church upstairs. I have a five-year-old that watched it last year that was, it was very traumatic for him. Amen. Unless you want to ask, answer a lot of questions, I suggest that you let your little ones go on upstairs. We have people in the lobby that are ready to meet you, that if you have little ones, they can go on upstairs to little church and they will have an absolute blast, okay? So that was full disclosure. But, you know, we couldn't do it without your guys' tithe and offering. Amen? And I think next year is going to be, what, our 75th year? 1950 when the church was founded. And we've been in this location since 66. And there's some families here today that have been here since the 50s. So there's a lot of history here. And I'm here to tell you, I got to believe we are one of the last of the Mohicans that actually still do a passion play. I mean, I don't think anybody out there is that aggressive where they still portray a crucifixion in a live audience. Amen? So without further ado, welcome to the Lord's church. We just had an offering. But, yeah. They already had offering. Oh, yeah. You guys missed your cue. That's all right. But without further ado, we're going to have our Easter program, and it's called Calvary is Enough.
Welcome. Today is Resurrection Sunday. Today we celebrate the day Jesus rose from the dead. Just want to give a warm welcome to everyone that's here on this rainy Easter morning and all that are listening by the live stream. It's a day we really celebrate the central truth of Christianity. Along with millions and millions of Christians around the world that share the same core convictions. These convictions are that Jesus is the Son of God. You have to believe that. He's the only way to the Father. We serve a crucified and resurrected Messiah. His gospel is real, and it's been working our lives, our daily lives. You'll hear that portrayed in the service this morning. And not only that, we're citizens of a greater kingdom. And one day God's going to make everything new. You can read about that in Revelations, the 21st chapter. There will be no more death, no more crying. And this wonderful message of Easter was literally bought at a terrible cost. Jesus died a death that he didn't deserve to die, so that those of us who have received that spiritual birth, where he said, you must be born again, might receive an eternal life that we didn't deserve. None of us deserve it. We're all sinners. But this morning we want to create just this event just to give you a slight idea of how terrible it was on that day that Christ died. But the Apostle Paul kind of has one verse that sort of just illustrates what it is. In 2 Corinthians, the 5th chapter, the 21st verse, Paul wrote, God made him that's Jesus, who had no sin, literally, to be a sin offering for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. Jesus died that we might live. When God the Father looks down, he looks through the shed blood of Jesus, and he sees us whole, because he sees Jesus' blood. So, the glorious truth is not only are we waiting for that glorious day in heaven, but he works in our lives today. You know, we've all been affected by past circumstances and unforeseen evil that literally we have no control over. No matter how hard we try, sometimes these things happen. And as a result of that, we carry scars and burdens that sometimes bring guilt into people's lives, and shame and fear and anger. They bring emotions to the head, you know, that will shape who we are and how we view others, how we view life. And they create barriers between us and God's plans for our life. But Jesus came to change that. Nothing we can do will change it, but we're powerless, but he's got all power. Nothing is impossible for him. And it's the cross that will bring us freedom and forgiveness. His cross was enough to wipe out the sins of the world. So as you watch the Easter story this sort of unfold this morning, let the truth of this magnificent message that Jesus died on the cross, was buried in the tomb, and rose up from the grave on the third day. Hallelujah. To prove to the world he was who he said he was. He was the Son of God. That truth will bring hope into your life, as he has done for millions of others who received him as their Lord and Savior. Let this program today be a blessing to your life.
My name is Robert Regan. I was abused from my father. He abused me when I was a child. And my family were atheists. My mom and dad did not believe in God. And then my sister got molested too, besides me. He used to give all of us, all my brothers and sisters, dog food. And we got sick and we had to go to the hospital and they had to take them out of our system because they said we could have died because of that reason. And he used to take the money. We never had any money in the house. He would go to the bar and get drunk. And so that's when he got mad. When he gets mad, he would take it out on his children. So that's when he took me down the 100 feet stairs and threw me down the stairs. Now I just remember falling down the stair, hit my head. They had to rush me to emergency. And they said my brain was so bad that I was gonna, that's when I started having seizures, and that's when I became handicapped because of that incident. They made fun of me, the people at school, the kids that would call me retarded and stuff like that. I was bullied in school because of that reason. He used to beat my mother up, and then when he beat her up, I didn't approve him beating my mother up. So I chose out of myself. I got my mom out of the house, and then he started coming after me because I was trying to save her. So I saved her. I went outside, we went next door. I told the neighbor, and then the neighbor, she called the cops and they came out and arrested him. And he got 5 years in jail. And he told me that once I get out of jail, I'm gonna come after you. I'm gonna kill you. So that's when I decided I was not gonna accept him as my father. I refused to have him as my father. And I told my mother that. I said, I don't accept him as my father. And my mother, she took him back after 5 years in prison. He came back, she took him back. I said, how could you take him back what he did to you and what he did to me and my sister? So that's when I ran away from home. I refused to live there with that man. And he tried looking for me. And he found out I was living in Long Beach. So he went down to Long Beach looking, trying to find me. So every corner I would go, I wanted to make sure that I would hide out in restrooms and stuff so he wouldn't find me. But all that was happening, it didn't seem to be getting better. It all started from when I was living with my dad and my mother. All that stuff started happening. That's when I decided I started taking drugs and started drinking. I was drinking every day because of all that trauma tore me up inside, and I didn't know how to handle it. At the time that was all happening, I wanted my dad dead. And when he died, I was not sad. I was happy. I didn't even go to the funeral because I refused to go to my dad's funeral because what he did to me. They say that God can heal all things, but I didn't believe that because that was all happened to me. Why would God not stop that from happening? Why didn't God stop me getting molested by my father? I used to think that God was no God because I always abused my own father. And he never stopped it. That's what I used to think. Until that day I walked by the Lord's church and I walked in there. So when that happened, I said, Lori, let's check out this church. And she said, are you sure you want to do that? And that's when I told her, no, I have a feeling something's going to happen in this church when I go in. I just had that feeling. And that's when Joyce came up to me and she prayed for me. And she said that God's gonna heal you, Robert. You gotta have faith in him. He's going to pay. He's going to heal you of all these things that's happened to you in your life. It took me a long time to forgive my mom. Because I didn't know how could I tell my father I forgive him? I would keep stuff building up in me. And when I would do that, it was having me have a lot more seizures. Because I was letting things build up in me. I was holding it in. I didn't want to bring all this stuff out. I was down front. And I got the Holy Spirit in me. Downstairs, you know how you do the praying down front? I still had the Holy Spirit. Miss Lori thought I had a seizure. I had the Holy Spirit that day. That proved to me, all that proved to me, there is a God. And that's when I wanted to be saved by God. And I feel much better now that I, because for a while I did not forgive my father. And I kept that inside of me for years and years. I wrote a letter to my father. I talked to my father with that letter, telling my father what I felt about him, why he did what he did. Because I never got to tell him, because he died before I had a chance to tell him how I felt. So when I did that, I told him, I forgive you, Dad, for what you did to me. And I felt good about it. It makes me feel I can open up now and I feel much happier. I'm much a happy person now because of God. I never felt that way before. God made me, he opened up to me, and I had a feeling inside my heart about God that I never felt before. And God brought me Lori. She's my life. If I would have never met Lori, my life wouldn't be the way it is now. And I met Lori's family. I mean, all those things start coming to play. And that's when I knew that God had something to do with all that. And that's when I started having feelings about God. To me, God is my father. Because I never had a father. Whatever you're going through, God will raise you up. Because I know what I went through was a lot. He ultimately saved me, yes, that's true. Because if it wasn't for God, I wouldn't be saved today.
Hi, my name's Gina. I've attended the Lord's Church off and on for 30 plus years. I was very blessed to have family and a mother who put me in church. And not knowing at that time that was going to protect me and mold me from the abuse that I was going to endure from this person who was supposed to protect me and mold me into an adult. But instead, what was brought into my life was fear and shame and guilt.
Everyone trusted him. And as he got comfortable, he manipulated the situation between, you know, with me and his position in my life, which caused me at a very young age to feel unsafe in my own home, very alone.
Sca- scared. Just very vulnerable. And it's just a tough place to be when you're 5, 6, 7, 8 and not have anyone to turn to. No one. Because I was taught very young to not say anything. The perpetrator of this abuse convinced me that I would lose my family that I loved, that was my backbone, that I would lose everybody and I would be alone. So that's why I never said anything. So I kept all that in. I didn't say anything. It's just a dark place. It was a very dark place. But what was interesting is as I got into church, what was really hard is at home, it was in a dark place, but I couldn't wait to get on the church bus to be in church where I felt safe. I felt so safe. I loved being there. And as I got older, the abuse got worse. Because then it got physical. And that's where I got confused. I'm like, okay, this isn't normal. And that's the time in my life where I just wanted to numb myself. I've done the drinking. I've done the drugs. Because I didn't want to feel anything. And as I got older, it was high school, I was 17. When I finally just broke and I got to speak up. And it was friends that stood by me. And God really gave me a strong mother. And thank God she's a believer. And when I finally felt I could say something, my mom believed me. You know, she believed me. She rallied up the family, and they all loved on me. Not one family member. Not one family member asked, why did you let it happen? Why didn't you say anything? But when you're in a situation, you just, and it has, I've just carried so much guilt. Because when I finally did say something, a lot of lives were affected. A lot. My brothers, my sisters lost their father. My mom didn't deserve what happened to her. Blaming myself for what somebody else did, that I hurt other people in the process, but I had no control of that. I mean, I was a little girl. But there's just been so much shame and guilt and fear of the people I may have hurt walking away. I was so afraid. I was afraid nobody would believe me for many years. Have carried that. And I think that's where I've blocked my relationship, getting super, super close with God. I allowed the enemy to get in my head and let me feel those things. You know, but I know that's not of God. That's not what the Lord has for me. But even though I knew that, I didn't surrender 100%. It was kind of like sometimes 75-25, sometimes 50-50. It wasn't until I had my daughter, who's now 18, and I actually was pregnant with her. I was 5 months pregnant, leaving church, the Lord's church. And Pastor Orville Carolyn had prayed over me, and I was driving home. And I got stopped at a red light, and I was in my worship in the car and just feeling good and close to God. And
I'll never forget. I'm at the signal, and there's this, it's just like a white cloud, and I see a little girl. I see a little girl with her hands out, and she's running and laughing and giggling, and she's got long brown hair with curls at the end. She had joy. She had so much joy. She was laughter. I didn't know at that time. Then I had my daughter. And that little girl has brought me so much joy. The restoration I feel was, I'm giving you your joy back. I'm giving you the laughter that the enemy thought he stole from you. Because my childhood was, I was in survival mode. My whole childhood, survival mode. I was so serious all the time, and that followed me into my 20s and my 30s of just being, surviving. That's all I knew. That's all I knew. But my kids have brought me so much joy. And then when I'm with them, that's where the laughter and the peace. But even now, I can sit by myself, which has just been recently, and just fall into God's arms and just feel his love and his arms around me, saying, Gina, I had you, I got you. You don't have to do it on your own. You're not guilty. You don't have to live in fear. I'm here. I did all that for you on the cross. I am where I'm at today only because of him. And I am just so thankful for what he did. When Jesus hung on that cross, I was set free. I have sat right here and just wept, and said, thank you, God. All those feelings that the enemy wanted me to feel, the fear, the guilt, the shame, it doesn't exist. It doesn't. I mean, I've gotten my joy back. I've gotten a lot of peace because I know that God has a plan. And even if that plan is for me just to draw closer to him, and that's daily, I think even at 55, I'm still drawing closer to him. But it's not easy. It's a relationship. It's a relationship, and now he's actually instilled in me a desire. A desire. I desire to be closer to him. Because that's where I feel most at peace. I feel loved. I feel forgiven. I know he loves me. He's giving me my joy back. He's really working on me letting go of the past that does nothing for me. And that's what the enemy wants. He wants to keep drawing us back, and he doesn't want me getting closer to the Lord, because God has a plan for everybody. So if we just let God take over and let him be present in our life, and you don't have to walk in that shame and guilt. And you have so much joy and peace because he's just a loving God. Loving God.
Amen. Those are two powerful testimonies. Amen. You know, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him shall have eternal life. You know, every time we look at the cross on Easter, I think Jesus is trying to teach us something through his suffering. And any of us that have ever partook in communion service, we just had communion on Good Friday. And right over here in 1 Corinthians in the 11th chapter, some of you are very familiar with this phrase. It says this, and this is Jesus speaking. Jesus is talking at the Last Supper, the night he's betrayed. He's going to be executed here not too long after this. He says this. He says, "For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." All week long, that phrase, "you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes," has been echoing in my head. And it's about the cross. It's about Jesus' death. And this morning, I think we should all look at the suffering that Jesus went through. And the remembrance, the sacrifice, grace came at a cost. Every time we see the cross, in the Latin, crucifixion, it literally means excruciating. And so we have a Savior that came down with us and suffered immensely too. You know, over in the book of Philippians, this is Paul speaking, the Apostle Paul. He's talking about wanting to know Christ. And he says there's two avenues that you want to know Christ. And the first avenue is you want to know Christ through the power of the resurrection. And the second avenue is you want to know Christ through the fellowship of sharing in his suffering. So sometimes we get to know Christ and there's power and there's victory. And then there's other parts of Jesus that you will only get closer to him and know him, as Paul's talking about here, through the sharing of his suffering. There are some parts of him that you will only obtain that intimacy that's forged through his suffering. And Paul says that we get to know him, that there is this bond. He is bringing us closer to him through the cross. This morning, he is coming very close to the very point of pain that you're in. And I'm here to tell you, God sent a Savior that knew what suffering was all about. You heard those two testimonies. Those are testimonies of suffering. And Jesus came and suffered too. And when we see, you know, every single one of us this morning came in here with something. Something from the past. Maybe there's something that we can't let go. Maybe it's our dirty, dark little secret that nobody knows. Maybe there's some of you that are carrying a burden that, you know what, you can manage, you can get through life. And then there's others of you that are literally being crushed by the weight of that suffering. Today, Jesus wants to meet you right there at that point of suffering. He wants to meet you right there at that point, as Paul said, through the sharing of his suffering. And when we look back at this point of the cross, we get familiar that Jesus was familiar with pain. Every rape, every murder, every molestation, every injustice was on the weight of Jesus on this cross. Why do you think he said, "Father, Father, why have you forsaken me?" So this morning, I encourage you to look at your Savior's face and enter into the fellowship of his suffering. Enter into what the Savior did for you. Now, I'm here to tell you, many of you have probably thought, "Well, you know what, Jason, you know, you don't know what I've been through, and look, at God's just forgotten about me. He don't even hear my prayers anymore." I'm telling you right now, that's from the enemy. That's not from above. And when you look into your Savior's eyes, I want you to realize that what Satan has meant for evil in your life, Jesus intends for good. This is one of the very first promises in the Bible. And you know, there's this area where we look into our Savior's eyes this morning. And as Paul says, we are entering in to sharing with his suffering. And there's a story that I can't help think about with Corrie ten Boom, who was in a concentration camp. This was during World War II. She was in a woman's labor camp in Germany. I think it was Ravensbrück. It was a concentration camp. And every Friday, they would gather the women and they would strip them completely naked. I mean, full-on humiliation. It was a horrendous place. You guys know what I'm talking about. And she's standing there, and the guards are laughing and mocking, and there's some jokes being told. And she's standing there, and she looks at her sister Betsy and says, "Betsy, I see him. I see Jesus. And he's naked too. He's naked too." And Betsy goes, "And we haven't even thanked him." I encourage you this morning, as you see him on the cross, enter in to that fellowship of sharing with his suffering. Because you will only know that part of Jesus if you take that route. Amen.
I resolve to know nothing but you crucified. Somehow in this room right now, it is enough. The weight of the world, too much for the souls of men. But somehow you hold it all upon the cross. Calvary's enough. Calvary's enough. When I know nothing, when I know too much, what I choose to know right now is Calvary's enough. You resolve to die, scarlet flowing from your hands inside. Covenant is sealed and ratified. You knew the cost. As the darkness fell and the temple curtain tore, the death I deserved, you made yours upon the cross.
So do you believe? Do you believe that he rose again? Do you believe that he came out of the grave? I think that's really a question that we sort of all have to wrestle with at one point in our life. And, you know, I love this chapter over in 1 Corinthians, and this is the Apostle Paul again talking, and he's talking about the resurrection. It's in chapter 15. And he writes this about the resurrection, and he starts to describe how hundreds of people, as he's writing this text, had witnessed the resurrection. These people were there. They saw him killed. And they saw him rise again. And so he's trying to help these people understand the significance of what Jesus' death and resurrection had on their life. And then he's also sharing with us the significance of what that means for our life here in 2024. And he says this. He says, and if Christ has not been raised, then your faith is useless. And you are still guilty of your sins. In that case, all who have died believing in Christ are lost. And if your hope in Christ is only for this life, we are more to be pitied than anyone in the world. And see, this is the kind of extreme nature of the invitation that God has set before you. This invitation to have an eternal relationship with him. And if you believe that he came out of that grave, amen, even though you think you die, you don't die. This is the claim. And what Paul is saying there is he's saying, look, if he didn't come out of the grave, folks, it's lost. Every opinion is lost. But I'm here to tell you something. Thank God he came out of the grave. Thank God he rose on the third day. Could you imagine if that stone could talk? Could you imagine if that stone could talk? He'd say, look, I ain't no cornerstone. I ain't no keystone. And I definitely ain't no tombstone. I'm a rolling stone that once the God, the King of Kings, that rose from the dead. Could you imagine when Jesus' heart started to beat again? We are talking about a resurrection, not a resuscitation. Life coming back from death. And when we look at this extreme measure, look what he says here in chapter 8, Romans. He says, that same spirit that rose Christ out of the tomb, when you believe, when you accept Jesus Christ into your life, that same power flows through your veins and you become a completely different individual. This is how you hear these unbelievable resurrected stories of their lives. People that have been born and raised in church their whole life, and then one day they have this incredible encounter with the risen Lord. There's some of you this morning that are followers of Christ. And you sort of, really, it's almost like you still think he's dead. You've been living life sort of with this grave power. I'm here to tell you that you can have the Spirit of God flowing through your life. We know this. Why? Because then he gives us faith. He gives us hope. He gives us life. He gives us joy. He gives us peace. And there's this invitation to every single one of us that you don't have to live the life that you used to live. You can turn over a new leaf. Paul talks about this imagery where you come out of the kingdom of darkness and you arrive in the kingdom of light. Those two testimonies you heard today, those were coming out of the kingdom of darkness. Today can be a day of belief. Today can be the start of your resurrection story. I don't care if you've been born and raised in church your whole life. I don't care if you've heard this Easter story till your ears start to bleed. Because trust me, I had heard it so many times by the time I was encountered by the Lord. I've been there. But I'm here to tell you, it's a day of salvation. And all you have to do is you put your trust in Jesus. You put your you sacrifice everything you have to him because he died on a cross. He's the one that conquered death. He's the one. Do you know what comes out of his death, his burial, and his resurrection? You know what comes out of that? That means any one of us can turn to Jesus and be completely forgiven for what we've done throughout our life. The scripture says it's wiped clean. Today can be a day of belief. The resurrection can be a day in your story. And the Bible says if you openly declare that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, guess what? You will be saved. You will be saved from sin. You will be saved from eternal separation from God. A lot of us have no clue what that is, but I'm here to tell you, it's nothing this world. You think you know evil here? Wait till you go to the kingdom of evil. Because there's no God there. There's no love. There's no joy. There's probably no communication whatsoever. You are in utter darkness, separated from everything. And in 2 Corinthians in the 5th chapter, this is such an incredible story because there is no story, there's no worldview out there, there's no philosophy or any kind of ancient text that has the story here in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, where anybody that is in Christ Jesus can become a completely new person. The old person is gone, and there is a new person that stands before you. All you got to say is, Jesus, I believe. I believe that you died for my sins. God is making a new creation, and that's what came out of the resurrection. We were living on a planet of death, and God breathed a living new creation through Jesus Christ's death and resurrection. I mean, folks, it changed history. It's a past forgiven. He's given us a reason for living, and eventually we're all going to spend time with him in a place called heaven. Amen. God bless.
darkness. Your hour is over.
Oh, yes, it is.
My God is victorious.
No enemy can hold you down, 'cause there's nobody in the green now. One head gets to wear that crown, 'cause there's nobody in the green now.
No enemy can hold you down, 'cause there's nobody in the green now. One head gets to wear that crown, 'cause there's nobody in the green now. No enemy can hold you down, 'cause there's nobody in the grave now. One head gets to wear that crown, 'cause there's nobody in the grave now. No enemy can hold you down, 'cause there's nobody in the grave now. One head gets to wear that crown, 'cause there's nobody in the grave.
Stand up as we wrap this up. You know, I just love what the angel told Martha. On the morning of the resurrection, she came to the tomb and the angel greeted her. He says, "Why are you looking for the living among the dead? He's not here. He told you this. He's risen. He's defeated death. The stone's rolled away. He's proven who he said he was. He's one of the only guys that ever claimed that he was the Messiah that actually completed the task. It wasn't just finished. He was resurrected. And we still talk about this today. Why? None of us would be still telling this story if this guy didn't come out of the grave. People witnessed this. The empire that executed him, that carried out his death, they found him. They found him. They turned to the cross. You can't make this stuff up. The gospel's founded on a bed of suffering, and God defeated sin and death through death. Amen? That's what stands before you this morning. And the choice is yours. What do you believe? What do you believe? Because Jesus, after that, he tells Martha this in chapter 11. This is what Jesus says, because one encounter with the risen Jesus can override a lifetime of unmet expectations. It can override a lifetime of unmet expectations. And look what Jesus tells Martha right here in John chapter 11. He says, Martha, I am the resurrection and the life. Anyone who believes in me will live even after dying. Do you believe this, Martha? And that's my question to you this morning, this Easter. Do you believe? Do you believe? Because Jesus Christ is screaming in front of you saying, I am the resurrection. I am the way. I am the truth. The only way to the Father is through me. Let's bow our heads this morning as we close in prayer. Because I want us to honestly give a genuine account. Let's wrestle with this question. Do you believe? Just like Jesus said, he's asking you, do you believe? Because all of eternity hangs in the balance with your response. And every single one of us, me included, we're going to stand before a living God, and the very first question he's going to ask you is, what do you believe about the Son of God, my Son, that died on a cross and rose again on the third day? And right now, if you believe in your heart and you confess with your life, you can enter in to this new life that he's talking about. Let's close in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, you talk about this new onos, this new wine that comes from the tree of life, Lord. Lord, there's people here today, Lord, they've been followers of you, Lord, but they've been living in the grave. Lord, breathe new life into their life. Let them realize that they can not only know you through the sharing of your suffering, but they can also know you through the blood of Jesus Christ and the power of the resurrection, where they came into this building one way, but when they walk out through the back, they're going to live another way. That life can begin right this very moment. A new beginning can begin now. A new life can start now. Lord, we ask you to come upon those that are wrestling with that question. The same question that Martha was asked. Lord, right now, whisper in their ear. You are the resurrection. He's the resurrection and the life. And when you accept him into your life, you're not going to be perfect. But all you got to do is say, God, forgive me of my sins in the past. And because of his death and because of his resurrection, I can have a new life forward. The beginning is now. That doesn't mean you're still not going to have any problems and everything's fine and hunky-dory. No, you might get attacked more, but I'm here to tell you, what Satan has meant for evil in your life, Jesus Christ can turn to good. You heard those two testimonies. The only way forward is through the resurrection. Lord, come on to those people that are wrestling with this question, Lord. Let them respond back, I want life. I want life. Come into their life. Give them that entrance from the kingdom of darkness, Lord, and into the kingdom of light. And we all said amen. Amen. Folks, it's not that complicated. It's not that complicated. He is the way and the truth and the life. And he is the resurrection. Amen? You can't deny it. But I'm here to tell you, if you want a new life, I know you guys are tired with everyday life. Jesus talks about it. Hey, life is a drag. And the problem with drugs and alcohol is they just sort of lose their sting, man. It wasn't quite like the first time, was it? You want a drug that will never end, and even though you think you die, you don't die? That's crazy. That is a crazy statement. He's the resurrection. He's the resurrection. He's the life. That same power, according to the Word of God, that rose him out of the grave, that we're still talking about today, can be inside of you. Amen? God bless. You want prayer? You want to talk about that new life? Come on down. You want to nail something down here to that cross? Something that's been suffering you? You want to share in that suffering with him? Come on down. Otherwise, God bless. And welcome to the resurrection.
I trust in God, my Savior.
That's why.